Access, Richard Walensky will host. Find more information on the KPFA website. For Chris Hedges, June 9th, Rebellion, What It Requires.
It's 2 o'clock on KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's time for Ballot Health with Nurse Rona.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. Before we start our show, I want to offer my prayers to the family of Wesley Burton and to the KPFA staff who worked with Wesley for so many years. I only knew him for a few months before he was killed by a hit-and-run driver on April 18th. His death is a great loss for all, especially his beautiful children and wife and family. You can go to kpfa.org, the homepage, to see his picture and learn how you can help the family. Lives are changed forever. I'm Nurse Rona, and I'll be joining you twice a month to explore different concepts of health and well-being. I've been a registered nurse for almost 50 years, and for the last 30 years, I've been working with children and their families as a temperament specialist, parenting coach, and author. I learned about today's topic many years ago when a doctor named Vincent Felitti came to Kaiser Oakland to talk with the staff about his work. The Adverse Childhood Experience Study that he pioneered, also known as the ACE Study, is one of the largest investigations conducted to assess the connection between childhood maltreatment and trauma and adult health later in life. The ACE study is a collaboration of the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and Kaiser Permanente's clinic in San Diego. More than 17,000 adults provided detailed information about their childhood experiences of abuse, neglect, and family dysfunction. Today, we'll learn about how this study is informing healthcare here in the Bay Area. Joining me in studio is Janine Greer. She's a health educator at the Center for Youth Wellness. She conducts trainings for children and youth on adverse childhood experiences and toxic stress. She has extensive experience working with various community-based organizations that are serving moderate to low-income individuals with psychosocial issues, and she also teaches psychology at the College of Alameda. Janine Greer, welcome to About Health.
Thank you so much. Thanks so much for the invitation.
It's great to see you here today. Also joining us is Zaya Malawa. She is a pediatrician at the Bayview Child Health Center in San Francisco. In her practice, she explores the connection between mental health and physical health and the impact of race and racism on well-being. Dr. Malawa, I'm so glad you can join us.
Thank you so much for having me.
I'd like to start off with you. There aren't many pediatric practices that work to address the special needs of children who have experienced trauma. So tell us a little bit about the Bayview Child Health Center and the ways it's unique.
So, as you mentioned, the Bayview Child Health Center is unusual in that we try to approach our patients with a holistic attitude, meaning we're not just looking at your physical health, but also your spiritual and mental well-being as well. And one of the conduits through which we can evaluate that is by looking at possible adverse childhood experiences that kids have experienced in the past or are currently going through, and trying to educate both the patients and their parents around how this might be impacting kids, and then develop strategies personalized for each family to help kids not experience the long-term effects of this trauma exposure.
So instead of just sort of putting Band-Aids on things in a way, you're really trying to see what this family has been through, what this child has been through, what the parents have been through. So it really informs you as a pediatrician as to what might be needed even down the line, maybe not even immediately, but down the line.
That's exactly right. And I have to say that this model has been really powerful because I've worked in community settings in Los Angeles and San Francisco throughout my entire career, but I've never had the opportunity to use this vantage point and then have the tools to actually do something about it before. And so it has been really powerful to be able to empower parents with this knowledge and help parents feel a sense of control in terms of creating a happy, healthy childhood and an eventual successful adulthood for their kids.
You know, I was thinking back to when Kaiser first started the domestic violence Violence Program, and Bridget McCaw brought this whole body of work to the medical professionals, saying, you know, if you don't ask the question, you're not going to get the information. And I remember how she put in place, with a lot of other people helping her, you know, a real protocol for how to ask the questions and then what to do when you get the answers. And I think that's what's so important. You know, if you're going to ask, if you've ever been a victim of domestic violence, for instance, you've got to know what to do when the person says yes. Mm-hmm. So the ACEs, which we'll get into more detail, is a way for you to ask questions and then figure out what care the children and families need. I think it's great. Janine Greer, the Youth Wellness Center, that opened many years after Bayview Child Health Center. And I'd like you to tell us a little bit about the people it serves and really how you're working to transform the way society responds to kids who are exposed to significant adverse childhood experiences and also toxic stress.
So part of what we do, a huge part of what we do, and my role at the Center for Youth Wellness, is building awareness about what toxic stress looks like, what ACEs look like in kids. The way that it works is that Dr. Malawa will have a client or a patient in clinic, and there is a screening done. An ACEs screen is completed, and if a child has more than two symptoms, am I right, Dr. Malawa?
If they have more than, well, if they have any symptoms at all, then we'll make a referral, or if they have an ACEs score of three or higher.
Three or higher, okay. And then they're referred to the Center for Youth Wellness for a wellness referral. So what does a wellness referral mean? That means that you can get wellness nursing. So for instance, if you have a child that is, let's say, suffering from diabetes, you can have a wellness nurse that can come home and actually do a meal plan with you and actually do some dietary planning with you. Or let's say you have a child that's suffering from epilepsy, the wellness nurse can attend the appointment with you, which I think is a really great service. We also offer psychiatry once a week. We have
psychologists. And then something that's very powerful that we've introduced recently is a biofeedback specialist to help some of the kids who are challenged with a high ACEs score or toxic stress kind of learn how to emotionally self-regulate.
Wow, that's great. That's something that you don't see very often. So this clinic is for what ages?
0 to 18.
Wow. That's fabulous. So you work together. This is a continuation.
The Center for Youth Wellness is our sister organization.
Yeah.
And so the intention is that we come together to provide a holistic model. And so while it's separate in physicality, we are co-located on the same floor of a small building. And it's important for us, for families, to kind of think of the mental health services and the alternative medicine services at the Center for Youth Wellness as an integral part of their child's well-being. We don't want them to think of it as separate from what the pediatrician does, but more as just one of many tools that the pediatrician has to offer.
Right. So it's not like, oh, there's something wrong with your child, I'm sending you to the psychiatrist, or I'm sending you somewhere else. It's sort of like, oh, this is what we offer. This is what we have. And it could look differently for every family.
Some kids might need an asthma inhaler. Some kids might need biofeedback. And we value all of those issues equally.
That's great. Well, I want to get into some details. Those of you who are listening, you may not have ever heard of ACEs, Adverse Childhood Experiences. And if you have any question at any time, please feel free to give us a call. The number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. We also have a toll-free number at 1-800-958-9008. So let's talk about, what are these adverse childhood experiences that we're talking about that Dr. Felitti and his co-facilitators, you know, developed over the years, so people understand. You want to start, Zaya?
Sure. So when Dr. Felitti did his first study, he looked at 10 main domains of possible adverse childhood experiences that people might have experienced. So they look at issues around household dysfunction. They look at issues around parental mental health, if kids have experienced neglect or abuse, if the parents have ever separated, if kids were food or housing insecure, those kinds of issues. And then emotional neglect is another important adverse childhood event.
Right. And if mother was treated violently, or if there's any sexual, emotional, or physical abuse. And I think you both mentioned that you added some things to the list. Do you want to talk about what those were? were?
So in addition to looking at the initial 10 that Vince Folletti put forth in his study, we also developed some questions that we think are also relevant to kids in an urban setting. So we ask if kids were ever in foster care, if CPS has ever been involved with their family, if they've experienced bullying, if they've had a serious medical issue, if their parent has ever been deported, if a parent has died. And we also ask if a child has ever been treated badly because of race, sexual orientation, place of birth, disability, or religion. Another important thing that we ask about is if the kid has often seen or heard neighborhood violence.
Wow. That's very comprehensive. And unfortunately, in our neighborhoods, you know, around the Bay Area, and of course, all over the country, there are too many kids who will answer yes to too many questions. Yeah, so maybe that's a good place for you to go right now, Janine, and talk a little bit about toxic stress. And you know, we use that term. I think people probably interpret it differently. How do you see that term? What does it mean?
Well, according to Harvard, there's three different sorts of stresses, and that would be positive, tolerable, and toxic. And we all need some sort of stress in our lives. Like if you're a track star and you're getting on the blocks and you're getting ready to run and you're waiting for the gun to blow so you can win the 100-meter dash, then that's positive stress. Tolerable stress is when something bad happens and you have parental supports to be able to support you through the difficulty. Toxic stress is when you have consistent, chronic, high-dosage adversity on a regular basis, and you don't have supports in place to be able to catch the child or catch the family. That's what we're talking about when we're talking about toxic stress. When I think of toxic stress for myself, I think of coming from a family who had adversity, and for instance, my dad has 10 brothers and sisters, and out of the 10 brothers and sisters, guess how many have heart disease? 9.
Wow.
So to me, that's what toxic stress looks like, the poor health outcome in adulthood.
Right, and there are lots of details around why those 9 mm-hmm. had heart disease. Yeah, so that's what we want to keep talking about today. You can call us at 510-848-4425. Let's take a call. Let's see who we have. It's Jamin from Oakland. Yep. Is that right?
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Am I on the air?
You are on the air.
Wonderful. I love this program. Thank you so much for doing it, and thanks each of you for all that you're doing. I'm 46 years old, and I had quite a stressful childhood. I've had so far a phenomenally successful career in the working world, but that's because for some reason I was able to persist through amazing adversity. What you're talking about in terms of the toxic stress,
yeah.
It's like, wow, she's telling my story.
Yeah.
And in fact, it wasn't until I discovered cannabis at the age of 42 that I was able to really kind of begin to kind of let go of this toxic stress and this kind of like PTSD.
Mm-hmm.
I look back. I could go on and on, but I'm going to let you talk. So
that's okay.
So
no, I'm so glad you called. And I was going to ask you, you know, what was your resilience? You know, because resilience is a big part of this. There are many people like you who need to look and say, oh, what happened? And then also look at, you know, what was it that made me resilient and made me successful? And what does success even look like? So besides the cannabis, what else was part of your resilience?
Oh, my goodness. Thank you so much for asking. I really love that you're kind of like rooting down or getting to the root of the topic. But what made me resilient was really creativity. I would kind of escape into this world where I would imagine and come up with new things. And then, of course, that became highly developed. But I was very, very introverted to the point that, you know, I just didn't date in high school, you know, other than when I was like, I don't know, essentially publicly asked and ashamed to, you know.
Turn it down.
You know, so I kind of survived, you know, a few dates in high school.
But creativity, see, that's beautiful. I love that you brought that up.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that can both help us be resilient and heal. Let me ask Dr. Malawa about what you're saying, because it's really important.
So I am also very glad that you brought this up, because sometimes when we are talking about this issue, I get concerned that people who have experienced adverse childhood experiences will think that they're now condemned to this certain kind of lifestyle, this certain mental health issues, these certain physical health issues. But emerging research is also showing us that different aspects of resiliency can be protective for kids and can help us recover. So when I think about resilience for adults, I think it really comes down to self-care. And self-care has many dimensions to it. Of course, you know, taking care of your physical well-being through good nutrition and good sleep is very important. I think having a spiritual outlet, whatever that looks like, is important. As you mentioned, creativity is hugely important, and fun. And you have to do all of these things. It can't just be one. You can't just have a lot of fun and expect that you're going to recover. You also have to make room for sleep and the nutrition and exercise. Creativity and mindfulness practice are all aspects of self-care. And when people use those in conjunction with each other, then it's very often that you can recover and have a healthy, productive life. I think for children who are being exposed to toxic stress and adverse childhood experiences, it's important for parents to realize that this is not a done deal. This is not the end of the story for their kids. And the more that parents can build loving, attached relationships, give a room for a child to be able to talk about what's going on with them and their feelings and feel heard and validated, for kids to feel loved and supported no matter what, these things are very protective. And study after study shows that kids who have experienced high level of adversity but also had strong, loving attachment to their parents can go on to live happy, healthy, normal lives.
Thank you. And Janine, I wanted to ask you in response to his question also, when you're working with people, is it sometimes, you know, the adults who you're working with, the parents, is it sometimes the light bulb goes off like, oh my God, I never really looked at my own adverse childhood experiences, and then they start to, realize the healing they need.
Yeah, absolutely. The great part about being able to conduct professional development workshops is that I get to see into the window of families. Still, it's always about people and families. So when you think about resilience, what does it mean? Are you talking about physical resilience? Just like Dr. Malala was saying, resilience comes in a number of different forms. Are you talking about only your mental resilience? Are you speaking about only social resilience? So it's just so exciting to me. And she was preaching to me on the way here about how I needed to think about myself more holistically.
Yeah, and also know that there are times when realizing the things that happen get really hard.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when we need support. We need support from friends or sometimes professionals. And then I always would remember, but tomorrow's a new day. And I'm really glad you called in, Jamin, if you're still there. And thank you for calling in. And please continue to listen. And if you have any other thoughts, I'd love to hear from you. We're talking about adverse child. You're welcome. We're talking about adverse childhood experiences. You can call us at 848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. Maybe you have questions or some insights about how you healed or are healing from the adverse childhood experiences that you experienced today.
I think that it's important to remember, and I'm always trying to, I feel like a broken record sometimes, I'm really trying to drum this idea home, is that if you've had adversity in your childhood, if you have ACEs in your childhood, that you're not permanently damaged. You're not damaged goods. Sometimes I hear that from people. Sometimes I see it on their faces when I'm talking to them about these topics. And you can heal. You can heal. You can do things to heal from difficult childhoods.
Yes, and so many people do. And I think it's the awareness that you're starting with. You're really trying to catch things early in a child's life. And I'd like to talk a little bit about that piece. And, what are some, these are the questions I have, what are some of the diseases you're trying to prevent? And why is it that if we face the ACEs and we understand the ACEs, why is it that we can make sure that our physical well-being is going to be better than if we didn't deal with these things?
Well, one thing that came out of the Filetti study is that people are more likely to have heart disease, stroke, cancer, diabetes, migraine, early miscarriages, and And when they've had adverse childhood experiences that are unaddressed in particular. There's the scientific mechanism of exactly what the steps are from the adverse childhood experience to these long-term chronic diseases has not quite been identified yet. But I do think that one of the powerful aspects of our model is that when we are asking parents these questions early on and at well child visits, it brings a different kind of awareness to the importance of how we parent our kids so that ideally we can be preventative in our approach.
Well, and I know that high levels of cortisol when you're under stress, so that fight and flight, if you're feeling like the bear is in the room, isn't that how you talked about it, Janine?
Yes, yes.
The bear is always in the room. You're ready to fight or flight. And so those levels of cortisol over time have an impact on your health.
Absolutely. Cortisol is an interesting thing. It can do some crazy, crazy things to your body. It can cause something called buffalo hump, which is it makes you store fat at the top of your or the back of your neck, and maybe you've seen people that have that. It can make you store fat around your middle. Yeah, lots of us know about the spare tire, right?
That's right. And it can keep, it can cause high blood pressure. It can keep your heart rate up, all kinds of things. So that's why we're looking at, understanding how these experiences impact. I was just thinking today that I grew up in poverty. We were very poor. And at 15, I decided to go and get a job. And I had to take a bus and a train at 15 by myself into downtown Brooklyn. And I did that to help add to the money in the family, but also so I had some money. But I realized I was putting myself at risk. I was putting myself at risk by doing that, and part of why I was doing that was because I was so poor.
I think that another really important thing to mention about the changes when you've experienced childhood trauma is we see a lot of kids with behavioral issues. And, looking at it through a traditional medical lens isn't necessarily going to get at the root of the problem. We see a lot of kids who are poorly emotionally regulated. We see a lot of kids who are extraordinarily withdrawn. We see kids that are having difficulty focusing and learning. All the time we get referrals from teachers who say that the kids have ADHD. But when we do the evaluation, in fact, they don't have ADHD and
PTSD.
Yeah, and putting kids who are dealing with toxic stress on stimulants is not always, and it actually, in fact, is rarely going to be the definitive answer. And so,
yes, that's another key piece that we'll talk about. Let's take some more calls, though. We have Dee with us from Daly City. Good afternoon, Dee.
Hey, hello. I have a question about living in a multi-generational home where the stress kind of originated out of necessity, and where could a family, the next couple generations down, the oldest generation's not so willing to change, but the next generations down are, and I'd love to know more strategies on how to do that and where I could learn these things. Books haven't been so helpful, a little therapy, but we're low income, so it's not so accessible.
Right. So I think what you're saying is, I work with a lot of families where, grandma or grandpa is in the home and the parents and then the kids and maybe sometimes auntie or someone else, and there's such different parenting practices. And I found that when I've worked with parents, a lot of the questions come up of like, on the one hand, I want to be respectful to my mom, and on the other hand, I'm saying, no, you can't be hitting or yelling at my kid.
Don't say that, or even being put down in front of your child,
right?
Your child gets the idea that that's okay.
That's
and
right.
I'm actually parenting the grandmother the mother, the grandmother. We have to stop now. And it's like,
right, so and then at the same
time,
it's very hard. And then also, like, you say no to the sweets, and Grandpa says yes, and so you're being sabotaged, I hear that all the time when I work with families, and I'm a strong believer in trying to do a family meeting, but before that, I think it's really about that one-on-one conversation with your parents about, number one, how things are different, and you recognize, your parent did the best they could in their time, but that we really need to get on the same page for the child's sake. And if you bring it back to the child, so we have different styles, but let's think about what, Jose needs. Let's think about what he needs as a child. Let me ask my guests here. Either of you want to jump in on this?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, this issue comes up a lot in our clinic, and I very much agree with you, Nurse Rona. One of the first things I do is I try to invite all generations to the clinic to have a group discussion, because so often it's a lot easier to hear it from not your kid.
Okay.
The professional.
The pediatrician, yeah, but, you know, even if I weren't, I just think. But, you know, as far as some specific strategies that you were talking about, here are some very simple things that you can bring to the home. So one thing I love to do at dinner time is gratitude practice.
Yes.
And so on the dinner table, to have just a jar that you can write down different things for which you're grateful, and before dinner, having a practice that all generations from the family throw something in there is a really important way to kind of shift your relationship with things that are challenging in the life.
Or even go around the table and say one thing I'm grateful for,
mm-hmm.
right?
And then, but I like writing it down, because then you can kind of start to see how abundant, in fact, your life might be.
That's mm-hmm. nice.
Another thing that I love to do with kids is kind of help them connect to their breathing, because we know that when people are feeling stressed, the first thing to go is your regulated breathing. And so I like to have, I call it like a breathing tool. It should be something lightweight, like a beanie baby or some kind of stuffed animal. It goes on the child's belly. And at night, when you're doing your bedtime routine, when they're laying still, you kind of practice. The kid puts their eyes on the breathing assistant, the breathing tool, and they raise it up for 4 breaths and down for 4 breaths. And for little ones, you're going to only do that for about a minute to start with. But if you do it every night consistently, then what you have is, when the kid is feeling dysregulated or when you're feeling dysregulated, you have this practice skill that you've developed in times that were not stressful that you can bring out. So those are two very basic things to start with that might make a huge difference.
You could have bubbles in the family. Buy some inexpensive dollar store bubbles and blow bubbles, and then say, for all of us, when we're feeling a little out of sorts, we get to pretend or really blow the bubbles. I mean, I think it's like, but you have to have the family recognizing that what's happening now, Dee, is not good for the child.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, Dee, I understand the type of parents that you're speaking of. Those are my parents. They're not going to participate in these lovely activities. We don't do that. So yeah. What I think is important to do is take care of yourself and find a supportive parenting community, whatever that looks like. Maybe that's you and two other friends.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever that looks like for you, it doesn't necessarily have to cost any money, but just getting together and maybe going to the park and letting your kids play at the park, and then you guys can have conversations so you can start to move your ideas about how it is in your house.
Yeah.
You know,
thank you.
Dee, I just thought of one last thing, that
okay.
sometimes when someone else isn't treating me the way I'd like to be treated,
yeah.
what I do is I treat them the way I'd like them to treat me. And I've done that with my mom or other relatives, where if I'm feeling like, God, I wish she would, you know, do something different, I realize I can do that. And so what you could do is see how you can change the energy in the home also by the way you are towards the people who are somewhat of a challenge.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay, Dee, thank you so much for calling in.
Thanks.
We're talking about adverse childhood experiences. You can reach us at 848-4425 or toll free at 1-800-958-9008. Let's take a call from Paul in San Francisco. Good afternoon, Paul.
Hi, good program. When you were asking the questions, I answered yes to about 60% of the questions.
Yeah, yeah.
I grew up in a fairly harsh environment. But what I found was most useful was I had great parents. I had a great father, mother, and stepfather, and they were all very helpful for keeping me together. And so I've been working the last 40 years doing interviews of people in the jails.
Uh-huh.
And I'm a doctor. And so one of the questions I get into a lot of these kind of questions in the jails, because we want to figure out how they got there. But one of the questions I always ask them is what their blood type is, because if you ask people that one question, it gets them to thinking about nutrition, and they'll carry that question with them for a long time. And so it's useful so that people can figure out, sort of like that saying, know thyself.
So you start with a very basic physical thing, and then it opens up perhaps to other things, Paul. And I'm sure by speaking to people in the jails, you're actually learning so much about adverse childhood experiences for other people.
Oh, yeah. I mean, most of them that we talk to, how they got there is adverse childhood experiences, and then they tried to take care of their stress by smoking cigarettes, stealing candy, stealing those little bottles of alcohol
at
the grocery store, and then they ended up going up a whole chain of drugs, and then they ended up with me. But another useful thing I find, having raised numerous kids, is collective parenting, I really think, is useful for parents so that they don't get caught in the couple's traps. Collective parenting used to be the way kids were raised 100 years ago, and we've lost it, and so we need to go back to collective parenting. So,
and do you mean by collective parenting like it takes a village? Is that what you mean by it? Yeah. Like, we are in this together, and there's more than me, and we're raising up this child, and we're looking out for them together. Paul, thank you for your voice and what you're doing. And, you know, when you were speaking about the jails, I was thinking about this question, instead of saying what's wrong with you, being able to say what happened to you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there are so many people we need to ask that question to, you know, what happened to you. So thank you again for listening, Paul.
Okay. Thank you for the program.
We're going to take another call. We have a call now from Stan in Oakland. Welcome, Stan.
Hi. Another good show. Very good. Appreciate your attention to this topic.
Thank you.
I do have a question. I'm on board with about 95% of everything that people are saying. My question concerns the experience of a child whose adverse childhood experience is the result of his parents or her parents or step-parents, or the, so that they don't have parents to turn to. Where does a child, and how does interventions from authorities help to prevent an increase in the actual adversity of their childhood experience?
Let me see if I understand you. If you're saying a child is being raised, say, by what? Someone who's...
A sexual abuser.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so you're saying if the pediatrician or the health educator is working with that parent, how do they mediate the effect of...
I'm actually interested in how the child can handle that, since most of your statement is your parents will help you out.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is a particularly challenging situation, and unfortunately it is not uncommon. And in those cases, one of the resilience strategies for that kid is to build their community outside of their family network, because not every kid has the luxury of being in a supportive, healthy environment, and not every parent has the internal resources to be able to be a healthy parent. And when that happens, and unfortunately it does, then part of the strategy is developing community connections outside of your family.
And that's where perhaps if the pediatrician even continues to give this child messages about how they feel matter, their feelings matter, the school starts to talk about feelings and safety, and at some point the child might even reach out to a teacher or a pediatrician and talk about what's actually happening.
I mean, as most of my patients know, I am particularly loyal and connected to my patients. My job goes way beyond the 8-to-5 thing that I get paid for. And I want my patients to know that if they need me, they know where to find me. I think that's important.
Part of what I do is go out and talk to teachers and community-based organizations about what toxic stress looks like in kids and what adversity looks like in kids. And so I want the teacher to be aware. I want the teacher to think about what does it look like. I want the after-school person to be aware. I want the janitor to be aware. I want them to say, oh, wow, Johnny is acting like X, and maybe that means something. And so maybe I need to alert the school social worker, and then perhaps Johnny can get some help if he needs it.
Yes. Stan, does that help a little bit with your question?
Yes, it does. I do, however... You got the sense that it's pretty invisible and can obviously going to be missed a good deal of time. So
yes,
a lot of the thing is looking back from an adult point of view at yeah. of childhood. So
that's right. And the more we talk about it here on the radio, in the clinics, I want to say that Dr. Felitti started his study when he started asking people in a clinic for obesity. He started asking them questions, and one of the questions was, what was the first sexual experience you had, at what age? And it turned out someone said age 4, and he said, no, I mean, what age? And they said age 4. And he said, in one of the talks I heard, he said, you know, in all my years so far as a doctor, I had only heard of 2 people who had reported to me that they had had incest or sexual abuse. So he suddenly thought, let me keep asking this question. Let me expand on this question. And he was so surprised to find out how many people, over 50%, said yes to his question. And so the more we have the resources and the courage and the knowledge, you know, to ask some questions, the more we're going to get answers that we could then help people with.
And I definitely fantasize regularly about having a Sesame Street version of what ACEs are, so little kids can know how to talk about and protect themselves from difficult situations.
Wow, that's bold thinking.
Good. Well, Stan, thank you for your calls. And I just also want to mention right now about ACES2HIGH.com, ACESTOOHIGH.com, ACES2HIGH.com. It's a website that has wonderful information. You can get every day, you can get news about the work that people are doing throughout the country, and, help to see how people are really pioneering this work and making a difference all over. So, again, thank you for your call. We'd love to hear from you. You can call us at 848-4425. We're talking about adverse childhood experiences, and we're talking with Janine Greer from the Center for Youth Wellness and Zaya Malawa from Bayview Child Health Center. Both of these are in San Francisco. Let's take another call. It looks like we have Jamin back on from Oakland. Hi.
Yeah, I feel like the cucaracha who snuck back into the radio studio. So you'll still have me. I'm back. I'm just like, after the last several calls and everything you're saying, I'm just like, amen, hallelujah. And I was the victim of sexual abuse as a child. And I just got to tell the story. And, part of the story, which is that the way that I acted out was largely through vandalism, theft, shoplifting,
yes.
Stuff like that.
Yes.
And but here's what happened. When it reached a critical point, when I was about 13, and it was I, myself, and a couple of friends, and we stole some bikes, and we got some chain clippers, and we were kind of going upscale. We were graduating to the next level. And when a neighbor found out about it, they didn't call the police. They called the parents of one of the kids. And they called the other parents, and, well, it just so happened that one of the parents happened to know one of the people who's kind of high up in the police force of the city, which I won't even mention.
Good.
Thank you. See, that privacy and anonymity is very important.
Yeah.
And you might even adopt a practice of not mentioning people's names when they call in, or at least...
Well, I that's a good point. Please, anyone who wants to call and doesn't want their name mentioned, please tell the screener a different name or just say no name, because I believe strongly that the beauty of radio is that you can be anonymous and you can call. So anyone listening, if you want to call, just give the wrong name, give the wrong town. Okay, keep going a little bit here.
Sure. So anyway, the basic message, we had this meeting with the police and everything, but it wasn't with the police officially, it was plain clothes. And the basic message was, you guys have too much to lose, and you have a community, families, everyone who supports you. Well, what about the ones who don't have too much to lose, according to that story, I mean,
yeah.
Rich white kids, they look out for us.
That's right.
It's just not
That's
fair.
Right. It's just not fair, and you've brought up so many things. First of all, I want to just say I'm so sorry that you had that trauma as a young person, and you're absolutely right. It gets acted out in so many different ways, and I just appreciate that, you know, you're saying that, because men often don't have the courage to come forth and say that, and, you know, I just want to appreciate that. And Janine, you know, he brought up the point, and we've talked a little bit about this too, that, you know, race does matter. Mm-hmm. Also, you know, ACEs is across all ethnicities, all socioeconomic classes, and we also know that, I know from my kids, I raised white kids, and I know that they had it easier than their African-American friends. There was no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm. I think the thing that sometimes, and I think that's why the ACEs screen was changed at the Bayview Child Health Center to reflect what the community looks like and to reflect some of the stressors that aren't necessarily seen. Certainly a person who is from a Mexican family who has immigrated across the border has different stressors in place. Certainly a young black boy who lives in Bayview Hunters Point, where there's lots and lots of violence, has different stressors. Their family has different stressors that they're holding and they're walking with.
Yeah.
I also think that one of the challenges is exactly what you brought up, which is that I think a lot of times kids of color don't get the same kind of generosity when people are looking at their misbehavior, and so there isn't that community sometimes in which to fall back upon. And so, you know, we see disproportionate rates of punishment, suspension, expulsion of kids of color in comparison to white students. And I think that's a perfect demonstration. You know, all ethnicities, cultures, and races experience ACEs at relatively the same rates. But maybe one of the big differences is how we are responding. And that's what makes me really proud to work at the Bayview Child Health Center, because, you know, our services are offered for free to the families that come to the clinic. So that they can also have access to really high-quality therapy.
Thank you, and thank you for the call. I'm sure we'll be hearing from you another week. I hope so. You have a lot of great insights, so you have a good day now.
Thank you so much.
Okay, bye-bye. Let's take another call. We have Chris from Monte Rio. Hi, Chris.
Hi. I'm 65. I was a child that was molested by my father and physically by both of my parents, and we were the kind of kids that I had three younger brothers. They were also physically abused, though not sexually to my knowledge, and we were the family that moved all the time. So by the time anybody would have maybe even had us on their radar, if they ever did, we would have already been gone.
Yes.
So nobody caught on to what was going on when I was a kid. I mean, all of my report cards said that I was absent-minded, that I, you know, I seemed to, like, if I would try harder, I tested better than I did in school and all that stuff. And, you know, I remember the first time I studied psychology in high school, and I recognized my family in so many of the things that they were talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And the shock and feeling this sense of hopelessness, because I thought I was condemned to be like my parents.
Right.
And then reading a book, I heard about a book about the resilient child. And the thing that stuck in my head was that they said that even kids who had the kind of abuse that I did, and I later went on as a young adult to get raped. So, I mean, it was like multiple things happening
Yes.
in my life, that if they had even one adult ever who showed them unconditional love and respect, that could make all the difference. And I locked onto that like a homing missile, and I thought of my grandmother, who I didn't see often, but I knew no matter what, she loved me no matter what. And
yes,
I kept that in my head even as I'm an elder now.
Yes.
When I'm under stress, I imagine the summer that I spent once with my grandparents when I was in sixth grade, and I imagine the dogs that were there and my grandparents, and that's how I got myself through the really hard things, and I went on to be successful as an adult. But the thing I actually want to bring up is that even if you have all these successes and you overcome all that stuff, I thought because I had been through so much that that I was kind of immune to any other stresses that could happen in my
life. Ah, interesting point. Mm-hmm. You're making a great point.
And I became a triage nurse at a county hospital, and I did a lot of really good work, but I thought that the stress that I'd had when I was younger kind of made me immune to any more stress. And in fact, it imploded. I ended up with PTSD and having to take early retirement. I did not understand that the stresses of that childhood could come back to bite me in the butt as an adult.
Well, I appreciate everything you said. First of all, I'm so sorry of the abuse that you suffered. I appreciate the resilience, you know, the idea that, you know, one person can really make a difference and that you could remember that and that could help heal you. But this whole idea of cumulative trauma, I think, you know, she's bringing up is really important, too. Do you want to say something about that, Zaya?
Yeah, you know, when we look at the development of, you know, psychology's understanding of PTSD, it was kind of based on this idea of a single traumatic experience, you know, mainly based on soldiers coming back from war. And I think that there often times is this myth that if you are experiencing cumulative trauma, you just kind of become increasingly inured. You develop a thick skin. But the reality is that cumulative trauma has cumulative impact. And, you know, one thing that you mentioned that I think was particularly interesting is that I think a lot of people are drawn to do work in communities or in work settings where they get to work with people who have experienced trauma because that's their own story and they can really relate to it. And I think that it is very powerful to have people who understand that on a personal level be on the front line. And I also think that these same people are particularly vulnerable because of the exact issue that you mentioned. There is an entity that is called vicarious trauma or secondary trauma, and that is basically the trauma that caregivers and people in helping professions experience when they're working a lot in traumatized populations. And it can be very impactful, and it can definitely interfere with your ability to function if you don't address it in a meaningful way.
Yes, and I think there's so much more to talk about, Chris, but I am going to go to another call. But I do want to say that I'm going to be doing, I think for the fund drive on May 11th, I'm going to talk about Rick Hansen's work. And one of the things he talks about is taking in the good. And it's almost like letting the good seep into your brain and your mind. And you gave such a good example of thinking about the good. And that in itself can help heal your brain and your mind. It's a complex subject, but I so appreciate you calling, Chris.
Thank you.
Yeah, take good care. Go nurses. Okay, let's take another call. We have a call from San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Yes, hi.
Hi.
I was listening to the program, and I talk about this a lot because I have a 38-year-old son, and we had a lot of issues lately, and I didn't know what to do or how to approach him or how to, you know, fix problems that, you know, he had in his childhood.
Yes.
And as I was listening to your program now, it struck me that, you know, there is a duality. Having been an abused child myself and having been an abuser, it was almost like a parallel life.
Yes.
When, you know, I was feeling sorry for myself for having been abused, but at the same time, I was so aggressive and so abusive towards my own child.
Yeah, so the cycle, it was hard for the cycle to be broken.
Well, no, I actually managed. That was a very important step where I managed to break the step where I realized that I cannot carry on like that. That was very good. The problem is I didn't understand that I was at the same time both the perpetrator and
Yes, and I'm having a little trouble with your radio or your phone, but let me see if I have what I could really feel how important it is. What you're saying is that some people can find that at the same time that they're doing something that could be called abusive or maltreatment or neglect, they are also simultaneously suffering from that same kind of experience that happened to them when they were young. Is that mostly what you're saying?
That's one thing. The other thing is that you know, I was thinking I got over my abuse. How come my son cannot get it over 30 years later? You know, how can't he just, you know, step out and go along and say, okay, Dad, I forgive you, forgave your parents, and I forgive you, and we are all a nice, big, happy family.
Right. But, right. So, and I don't know what's wrong, whether it's the radio or your phone, but I'm having trouble. So I may just need to say that, in fact, healing happens at different rates, and forgiveness can't come until someone's really worked through a lot. And it happens at different times. 38 isn't too late. So one thing is don't give up. Don't give up. You definitely don't want to give up, knowing that it's still possible. And there's a lot of work, and at least there are supports now out there. My guests, you want to add to what this brave man is saying?
Yeah, thank you so much for sharing your heart and your hurts with us over the radio today. I think that it is important to remember that forgiveness is for the self. It's not so much he might be stuck in the loop of thinking that he's forgiving you, and so he's letting you off the hook for some of the bad things that happened a long time ago. But I think that comes with some time and some processing. I don't think that that's something that happens automatically. And he has to be ready. He has to be ready, and we get to love him through that anyway.
And a lot of self-compassion for realizing that you didn't know what you didn't know, and you couldn't stop what you couldn't stop, but now you can have compassion both for yourself and for someone else and let go of some of that, those hard emotions as you can.
Mm-hmm. One thing that comes to mind for me is the caller from before who talked about how she just needed one adult in her life that showed her unconditional love. And I think a really powerful healing message is for you to be that one adult for your son, even though he's an adult, to show him that unconditional love, but also for you to be that one adult for yourself and show yourself that unconditional love. I think that if you can approach the situation with compassion for yourself, understanding that when you experience trauma, it changes you. And, you know, it changes your ability to self-regulate sometimes. It changes your memory. It changes your fear structure. It changes you. And so to treat yourself and your son with compassion, I think, is the first step for healing.
Thank you very much. And we're talking about adverse childhood experiences and the effect it has on adult health. And again, it could be mental health, physical health. We really appreciate all the calls. Let's see. We can take another one now. We have Catherine from Berkeley. Thank you for calling, Catherine.
Good afternoon. Thank you for your show today.
You're welcome.
My question is more geared towards resources available for the pediatricians and the healthcare providers that we may have in our lives that are either our own healthcare providers, our own pediatricians, or friends or colleagues that are specifically working with children. How can we let them know about this work that's happening, this research, and about the resources that are being talked to right now? You know, if there's some way that we can email them or give them a flyer or something to let them know about strategies, about resources, or maybe contact people in the States or internationally for them to learn more and get connected. And
great, that's great.
I'll take the answer off the air. You're welcome.
Thank you for the question. You know, on my website, nurserona.com, I posted some of the links to Dr. Felitti's study. I posted an amazing TED Talk by Dr. Nadine Burke, who started the centers with these terrific guests we have here today. There's ACES Too High, ACESTOOHigh.com. And then for professionals, there's ACESConnection.com. Why don't you tell us how people can also reach you and also any other resources?
Well, so another important resource for pediatricians is actually on the American Academy of Pediatrics website. So in the last couple of years, the AAP has done a huge push to get pediatricians educated around this important aspect of child health. And so you can always refer your pediatrician in there. And then, you know, our clinic is located in San Francisco. It's called the Bayview Child Health Center. We accept all insurance except for Kaiser, including Medi-Cal, if it's in the San Francisco County. And we are always happy to accept new patients who are dealing with trauma or not. Our phone number at the clinic is 415-697-0500.
And I'm sure someone there would answer questions. And I think people all over the country, again, if they connect with acesconnection.com, they could find out who's doing what where so that people can keep informing their own practice. And Janine, for you, in terms of any other resources or how people can reach you?
So you can reach me at the Center for Youth Wellness, and or you can email me. I'm a big fan of email, jgreer@thecenterforyouthwellness.org. I know that's kind of long, but just spell it out and it'll get to me. If you're interested, if you have professionals that are interested in having professional development workshops, community-based organizations like the YMCA, or let's say your child is at a particular school and you feel like they're not as versed in this whole idea of ACEs as you'd like, give me a call and I'd love to come out and deliver a workshop for you.
I also want to mention, for people in the Bay Area, there's a movie called Wounded Places, Confronting Childhood PTSD in America's Shell Shock Cities. It's just 32 minutes long and it's one of the supporting episodes in the forthcoming documentary series that's called The Raising of America, Early Childhood and the Future of Our Nation. And that's now in production. So this showing will be at the Grand Lake Theater in Oakland on Wednesday, 4/29/15, this Wednesday, at 6:30 p.m. And I know that Wilma Chan is going to be moderating a panel afterwards, and the mayor of Oakland will be there. Do you know anything more about the movie that I should say? No. So Wounded Places is showing. You can go to their website that I don't know, but I'm sure if you Google Wounded Places, you'll find that out. So as we start wrapping up here, I think I'd like to ask each of you to say something either about resilience or about adverse childhood experiences, you know, something that we forgot to say, because there's so much to cover on this subject, and I think this is the first of other shows that we'll do. So how about for you, Zaya?
I guess I think that the most important thing is that parents feel empowered to take care of their kids however that looks. And so I really agree with you, Nurse Rona, what you talked about, which is how important it is for parents to get healthy if nothing else happens. You know, a lot of times we'll see a kid in clinic and they'll have a lot of symptoms of trauma. For example, their sleep will be dysregulated and they're always getting in trouble for acting out at school and at home, and they have an unusually high fear response, but then we'll do the ACEs screen and their score will be zero or very low. But if you were to do their parents' score, their parents' score might be incredibly high. Mm-hmm. And so I think that one of the most important aspects of raising a healthy kid is taking excellent care of yourself as a parent.
Thank you so much. And how about for you, Janine?
Well, I like to think of it like this. If, let's say, you fall and break your arm and it heals a little differently. You know, let's say it's a little crooked.
Yeah.
And it just is a little different. It doesn't mean that you can't live a productive life. You can heal from these things and still lead a productive life.
Well, thank you so much. Thanks to all the listeners today, and many thanks to Dr. Zaya Malawa from the Bayview Child Health Center and Janine Greer, health educator at the Center for Youth Wellness in San Francisco. And I'll be back in a few weeks, but in the meantime, you can always reach me at my website at nurserona.com. And again, I have ACE links there for you to take a look at. Dr. Lenoir will be your host next Monday. My gratitude to our board operator, Jill, and our producer, Felix. Health matters, and so do you.
When you think of the Hard Knock, you think of that.
Station of Resistance.
One of the most phenomenal beats of all time.
Good information and great radio.
News, views, and hip-hop.
What? Do it the way you feel it.
Hard Knock.
Hard Knock.
Hard Knock Radio.
Monday through Friday.
And it's from 4 to 5 p.m. knocking hard in your area.
94.1 KPFA.
Only revolution is our evolution.
So good.
save the date for KPFA's Summer Arts Fair, June 20th and 21st, 2015. KPFA now presents a festival of art not just once, but twice yearly. Both events are held at the historic Craneway Pavilion on the Richmond waterfront. The KPFA Summer Arts Fair, showcasing the handmade unique work of 200 artists and craftspeople. The dates, June 20th and 21st, at the Craneway Pavilion. There's a free shuttle from the Richmond BART station if you drive or carpool. Free parking is plentiful. This event is wheelchair accessible. Two-day admission is $12. Seniors and disabled, $8. Youth under 18, free. The KPFA Summer Arts Fair, a benefit for listener-sponsored KPFA. More information at kpfa.org/craftsfair.
Good afternoon. You are listening to 94.1 FM KPFA here in Berkeley and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online.